It's really nice to be back here. I now actually, my son has a house now in San Golda, so I come here every winter, and Goa is becoming part of our lives. How we spend our moments is how we spend our, how we live our days. And how we spend our days is how we live our lives. So, how we spend our moments like these is how we live our days, and how we live our days, how we spend our days is how we live our lives. Let me begin with a thought experiment. Let's play a thought experiment together. Imagine you've come out of a doctor's office and she has diagnosed you and you've got the depressing news that you have only 3 weeks to live. And the question is in your mind, now how am I going to live these 3 weeks? So certainly I'm not going to go and get an executive MBA now, right? Nor will I take a crash course in public speaking, right? Nor will I suck up to my boss so that I can get the next promotion. And nor should I be picking up a quarrel with my neighbor, as is my habit. So this, actually, the idea is to focus our minds as what we do in the next 3 weeks is how we want to live our lives. Every day we spend in the next 3 days is every day. I mean, we all are under a sentence of death. So the purpose of this game really is to remind ourselves that we treat our lives very casually as time pass. We sleepwalk through our life. Or we are good, we listen to our mother and father, and we study hard. We get good marks, and then we get into a good college, like the students who are here today. And then when we are in college, again, we take safe subjects, so we get good marks. And then, so that we get a good job, and so we get a good job. And at the job, we work hard, and we get promoted and we climb ladders. We get a nice house, then we get a bigger house. We have children, we send the children to good schools. And somewhere in midlife, in our 40s, we ask ourselves, is this what life was all about? So, you know, it really brings up again, like the thought experiment we played, it raises the question of what is, why are we living? What's the purpose of it all? And the purpose is the purpose that many of us wish to seek, because we are not like Mozart. Mozart, at the age of 3, knew he was a musical genius. Luckily, his father had given him a violin when he was 3, and he picked it up And then he also discovered that he had perfect pitch. Meaning if he heard a tune, he could immediately repeat it. Well, he lived his life with that purpose, creating 625 works, great works of music, and until the age of 31 when he died. Well, in our case, we don't know what is our purpose the way Mozart knew. And so, you know, we feel a bit guilty that we don't know what is our purpose. But the fact is, it's perfectly all right not to know one's purpose. The fact people will say, oh, you have to find yourself. No. You have to create yourself. There is no God-given purpose. Or there is no God-given you who has a certain purpose. You create your purpose. And also, one shouldn't feel too guilty, because the opposite of this is those who plan their lives. Who plan their lives. I mean, one young man came for an interview to me, and after we talked, I said, do you have any questions? And he says, yeah, what is your retirement plan? I said, you're 22, and you're worried about retirement today? So there is a habit in some of us to overplan your life. And there's not enough room for spontaneity. And as they say, I don't know, I think Seneca said it, while I was planning, life passed me by. So that's the other problem in this. But it is a duty of parents, duty of teachers, to help someone discover what they like, what their purpose is. And so, to end this thought experiment, let's go next step. You're about to die, right? So what will be the last words in your last breath that you will want to utter? Think about that. What's the last thing you will say? You could say, I've lived. How about that? I have lived. And what a wonderful thing it was. You could say, like everybody else, the human tendency is to really be to project forward. That's why we're always thinking, now what am I going to have for lunch today? You know, we're always thinking ahead. We're not thinking at this moment. And so, your last words, what's next? That's a nice last word. What's next? Anyway, let me leave this as homework, especially for the kids here. You've got a lot of time now, but play this experiment with yourself and figure out what is it you'll do in the next 3 weeks, if you have only 3 weeks to live, and what will you say in your last breath if you have one breath left to live. Now, I'm going to try and tell you three stories. If there's no time, at least two will do. And the stories are really meant to stimulate this idea. The idea that what what is it that we should be thinking about, what or looking for a purpose, or how to find a purpose, and what it is to live with a purpose, and what it is not to live with a purpose. The three stories I will tell are my own, not because I'm more important than you, but just the fact that I know myself, meaning one person's life, honestly captured, is the only true data of history that we have. And by the way, this is time for a short commercial break. I have a book coming out in October, which is a memoir, the story of my life, which is called Another Sort of Freedom. What is that other sort of freedom? I leave you with that question. Read the book and you'll find out. So one will be my story. The second will be the story of my mentor, who came to work in my company as an assistant security guard. He was not a graduate, matric pass, from a village in Akola district in Maharashtra. This was his first visit to Bombay, his first job, and he was such a Dehati that he would pronounce the name of our company, Procter and Gamble, because his name was Gamble. And the third story, if we have time, is the story called The Mouse Merchant, a story from the 12th. That first two are true stories. Second one is a fictional story from the 12th century text called Sanskrit text called Katha Sarit Sagara, Ocean of Stories. And it's an inspiring story for the age of startups. And since we are in the age of startups today, and especially for young people, I think you'll find it of interest. Okay, so begin with my story. My first memory is that when I was 4.5 years old, I was in kindergarten in Lahore, in model town Lahore, which is of course now in Pakistan, because I'm a refugee. And I came home with a report card, and my mother was waiting at the door, and she saw me, you know, waving this green piece of paper. And she looked at me and she asked me, "Did you stand first?" And my father was close by, nearby her, and he said to her, "That was the wrong question. Ask him what he likes about school. Does he like to draw? Does he like to read? And who are his friends? And there's other things you should ask him." And so, you know, I come from a middle class Punjabi family, and my mother was suffering from the usual Punjabi middle class anxieties, actually every Indian middle class anxiety, meaning this boy will have to make a living one day. And so he better do well in studies. My father was reflecting an opposite opinion, which was not making a living but making a life. That is where the title of this talk is, the difference between making a living and making a life. Now, all of us, most of us, unless we are very wealthy, have to make a living. But we forget that we also have to make a life. So that's really the purpose of this talk. And so I grew up in this middle class family. Actually, the year was 1947. It was March when this memory is there. After partition, we fled for our lives like 10 million other Indians. And I grew up in free India, post-partition India. And this theme of making a living and making a life stayed because my mother kept reminding me, whichever class I was going to, that you better study hard and do well. So out from when I was 16 and a half, 17 almost, I had the unbelievable good fortune of getting a scholarship to go to Harvard. And I still remember, it was Palam Airport in Delhi. I was to take an Air India flight, and my mother's in tears, saying goodbye, and then she says, remember, you have to make a living. Study something useful at Harvard. When you come back, she says, why don't you be like your father? He's an engineer. Then you'll get a job. So she knew that. Anyway, there I fly off to Harvard, and the very first day, I see the catalog of courses, and my mind is blown by the courses that were available. And I forgot my mother's advice immediately. For the first 2 years, I took courses in Greek tragedy, the Russian novel, Renaissance painting, Beethoven, the music. And then I came home for the summer, and for the first time I saw poverty in the country. You really have to go away, out of India, to come and appreciate the fact that we have such poverty. And so I said I must study economics. So I came back and I enrolled in economics. But I also studied Sanskrit love poetry. And I mean, I could give you a real list of things, but the beauty of an American undergraduate education is that they don't force you from day one to major in one subject. And so, like a honeybee, I was going from flower to flower, till even Harvard got worried in my third year, and they said, my dean called me and he said, son, you got to declare a major now. And then, you know, you must take minimum courses in that major. And so I chose philosophy. Why? Because I wanted to know the meaning of life. I wanted to know how to be a good person. And things that we all think about. What is a flourishing life? So I got my degree in philosophy, and and after Harvard, you can see this Harvard experience was what? It was what my father had talked about, that I was at that point concerned with making a life. And books, why reinvent the wheel? Somebody's already figured it out. So you read books and you learn how different people made their life. And anyway, I got a scholarship to Oxford to do a PhD, and I came home for the summer, and my mother was happy at least that she thought I would have a job at least if I did a PhD in philosophy, although she was still worried. About it, what kind of a job with philosophy, she was asking. Maybe he'll get a lecturer in some small town in Roper or Jalandhar or somewhere like that. Anyway, so that summer, one day I asked myself, did I really want to spend the rest of my life at that stratosphere of abstract thought, philosophy? I said, no. I wanted a life of action. So what was I doing going to Oxford? So I promptly wrote to Oxford to say, sorry, I'm not coming. And my mother's worst nightmare came true. She had an unemployed son at home. And she had a nosy neighbor who used to ask her every day, "Thoda munda ki kar raha hai? What's your son doing?" And the poor thing wouldn't know what to answer. And I could see her embarrassment. And to save her embarrassment, I looked in the paper every day, and in the newspaper, in the Times of India, there was an advertisement for a company that wanted trainees. And I didn't know what a trainee was, but I still applied. And I got the job. And this was the company that made Vicks Vapor Rub. And so I think they got impressed with my Harvard degree, which is why they gave somebody who was a philosophy major a job. But in those days, we didn't have this MBA obsession. And anyway, so suddenly from a promising academic career in ivy-covered halls at Harvard or Oxford, I was walking the bazaars, dusty bazaars of India, going to chemist shop, asking, bhai, kitna lena hai? Ek dozen, do dozen, you know. So it was a very different life. And while my mother felt reassured that this boy was able to make a living, my father said, don't worry. Experiment. If you don't like it, you can always do something else. And it's true. I thought this was going to be just an experiment for a few months or a year or so, but like the man who came to dinner, I stayed on. And I began to like the rough and tumble of the business life.
हॅलो टोटल अजूनपर्यंत 15 भुरगीं शेणल्या सर हय सर चडशीं 7 ते 10 वर्सां आं शाळेंत सोडल्या तुमी
शाळेन शाळा आसतना दिवस जाणा सायब
आनी आतां तर सुटी पडल्या तुमी आनी कितें सायब
सर सुटी पडल्या आतां तुमी आनी कितें सर ना सॉरी सर सॉरी सर ना हय तुमी म्हणटाले हांव वचून पळयता आतां इतली बरी शाळा चोरानो म्हजे कडे खेळटा गोवा पुलिसा कडे
सॉरी काका
सॉरी सॉरी बी काय ना खंय आसा ती बाकीची
भुरगीं
चला या आता घरा अरे भुरगी पहिली शाळेन वचपाक रडटाली आता घर वचपाक रडटा वो कसलो रे चमत्कार
चमत्कार न्ही आमचो गोय सरकार
अरे गावान गावान जर अश्यो सुंदर शाळा जाल्यो जाल्यार भुरग्यांच्या शिक्षणा बद्दल भिवपाची गरज ना
भिवपाची तू आता आमका घरा वचपाची गरज ना
नव्या तमाचे सर तुतराचे हे आमचे सरकार प्रभुसवंताच्या खाला सपना जाता साकार नव्या तमाचे सर तुतराचे हे आमचे सरकार प्रभुसवंताच्या खाला सपना जाता साकार गोयाचो फुलारे फुडार खोशिया सारे गोयकार युपाची काय गरज ना
आता
दरेक गोयकाराचो आधार डॉक्टर प्रमोद सावंताचे गोय सरकार.